Hello everyone. In this video, we are going to learn about the seismic filters and their types. So this video is actually the part of module 2, which is seismic filter and GAN. So this module consists of 3 videos. The first one is we will be discussing about seismic filters and their type. Then we will be focusing on the multiple and FK transforms. And in the third video, we are going to discuss about the GAN, their types, and how we use these. So let's focus on the seismic filters and their types. So in the end of this video, you will be able to know about the filters, their types, and use in seismic data processing, and why we use this type of filters in seismic data processing. So if we are looking at the types of filters which have been categorized based on different phenomena such as the frequency, inverse filtering, and velocity or FK filtering. So if we are focusing on the frequency filtering, so in that we have 4 types of filters, which is low pass, high pass, band pass, or notch filter. So these filters, either you can call it low pass or you can say high cut. Or high pass or low cut, band pass is the same terminology used for every filters. Then we are will be focusing and discussing about the notch filter, which is a special filter used for certain band of frequencies to remove from the seismic data. Then we will be looking or we will be having some introduction about the deconvolution processes, such as deghosting, which we have discussed in the previous lecture as well. Then we'll be having some introduction about the wavelet and signature deconvolution, and predictive deconvolution will be focusing on the second video. I will be showing some of the velocity filters, which is used for seismic data removal. So first we move to the frequency filtering, which is the focus of this video. So basically the seismic data processing is done in frequency domain. The original time domain data is converted to the frequency domain by applying the forward Fourier transform to make processing easy and filtering easy and cost effective. Because when you are looking at the time domain, it is not much easier to remove the certain band of frequencies, noises, or preserve the frequency which you are asking or you are required. So here is the first trace which is looking here. You can see the original seismic trace. So if, let's say, you are not focusing or you don't need the high frequency data, then you have to apply the low pass filter. So after low pass filter, you can see only the low frequencies are here, but the higher frequencies are removed. Similar way, if you are want the higher frequency, especially when you're looking for thin bands in the subsurface, then you can apply the high pass filter. So high pass is only passing the high frequency. So over here in this trace, you can see the low frequency data has been removed and the high frequency data is absorbed or remain in the data set. So there are another filter which is called the band pass filter. So in that filter, you have some limitation. Let's say you want from 10 to 20 hertz or 20 to 30 hertz for certain band of frequency, which is normally used for spectral decomposition. So in that you can also use these type of filters. Then again, we have another filter, which is band stop filter. So let's say if you don't want to have some frequency, such as if the frequency is coming from the noises of the like power induction line, then you can use the band stop filters. I will discuss all these filters in detail as well. So if we look at the spectrum, how does it look like? So on the x-axis, we have the frequency, on y-axis, we have the amplitude. So how does we define in the x and y-axis, which is amplitude and frequency? So low pass frequency is actually allowing you to pass only low frequencies, which is over here. And similar way, the high pass or the low cut filter, so it will cut these frequencies and absorb only this frequency in the data set. In band pass, so this red line is actually showing the frequency which is kept in the data set, and the frequency which is in between this red scale, then you have to remove this. Notch filter is obviously used for certain range of frequency. Let's say if you want from 50 to 60 hertz, then you can define a notch filter which can remove these type of frequencies from the seismic data. So there's also, we use some of the unit for frequency. So the decibel is actually, it's a non-dimensional unit for of the scale. So how does it be counted? So from this expression, D is equal to 20 log 10 Y over X. So this is the expression from where you can find out the decibel frequencies of the data. So let's say if you have the Y is bigger than your X, then X is in dB decibel down in comparison to the X. And in other way, if your Y is equal to double of the X values, then your decibel is approximately 6 dB. So, and also another term we use for octave. So octave is normally we call some frequencies in decibel per octave. So the an octave is actually doubling of the frequency. So let's say if you have the 120 hertz, so an octave above 60 hertz. So it is actually the doubling of the frequency. So here is further explanation of the low pass filter. Sometimes, as I mentioned, it also can be used as a high cut filter. So what actually is doing the preserving of the frequencies from this value, which is from P to Q. Q is your high value cutoff frequency and P is your low value. So from this range, you will have the frequencies, which is over here only. And the amplitude is obviously you are preserving the all amplitude of your seismic trees. Then second one is a high pass filter. So in high pass filter, as described before as well, so we have two cutoff frequency, which is P and Q over here. So on X axis you have the frequencies and on Y axis you have the amplitude. So P is actually the low cut of cutoff frequency. So this is actually, so why we explaining this slope, I will explain this. Why we have to define this slope. If we can have this type of cutoff, but we don't want to do because of this, we can have the Gibbs effect. So that one is a next topic. I will explain in a minute. Then the bandpass filters, which is the frequency response from P and Q from this point to this point, and the frequencies are defined at a point of amplitude of A, which is the amplitude A here, where A is 3 dB, which is over here, is down. Then in exploration seismology and exploration geophysics, what we are discussing in this this course is actually exploration geophysics. So why we have to define this bandpass filter, because sometimes you have the some of the frequencies which is produced from the noise, from the power induction line or the continuous, let's say if you have the streamer and the noise of the streamer is continuous and it's coming to the seismic data. So then you have to remove these type of frequencies. So then the last one is notch filters. So it is also called the band stop filter. So the frequency is normally known as the notch filter, which is M is defined here, which is the notch cutoff frequencies, and it is often used for 50 hertz normally in UK and 60 hertz in US. So sometimes you have the power induction line which have 50 to 60 hertz. So normally we remove this type of frequency from the seismic data, especially if you are having this data set in land case. So another type of filters, which is very important, which is called Ormsby and Butterworth. So Ormsby can be said as a zero phase, and Butterworth is also called the minimum phase filter. So these filters are usually zero phase or minimum phase, although the types of filters can actually be either phase, and this should be clearly stated in the given seismic survey. So the bandpass of the zero phase Ormsby filter is usually defined by up to four quadrants. So over here is an example. So over here you can see we have four defined frequency, which is from 5, 10, then 50 to 70 hertz. So this is actually the bandpass. So these frequency will be absorbed in the seismic data, and the other frequency, which is very low frequencies from 0 to 5, will be removed. And The second type of filter is actually the zero phase or the Butterworth filter. So in that, what we are doing, we are defining two frequencies and also the cutoff frequency. So over here, you can see the bandpass filter is here. And here we have defined 80 Hertz, which is the low cut, and the 60 Hertz is your high cut. Then this 36 dB per octave is actually the slope of your data set. So here I will explain more on the Gibbs effect, but before that we can have one example, which is from accessgeo.com. So over here is the original seismic data, which is the actually it's a spectrum, amplitude spectrum of the raw seismic data. So over here you can see this low frequency noises, which is normally the soil noise, is in our seismic data. Then we have defined, which is shown in the B figure. So over here we have defined four cutoff frequencies, which is F1, F2, F3, and F4. So after this cutoff frequency, then we have the Butterworth filters, so which is defined by the amplitude spectrum of the design filter operators here. Then in Butterworth filters, what we have to do, we have to define only two frequencies and two slopes, which is S1 is one slope on the left side, which is shown here, and the second one is on the right side, which is actually defined dB per octave. So here, sometimes your question arises, why we have to define these frequencies from 5 to 10 Hertz or like that. So another thing which is I was mentioning, that why we don't define like 5 to 6 and 50 to 51 Hertz cutoff frequency. But because of if we're defining very steep slope of the frequency, then we have some of the ringing effect. So ringing effect is looks like this. So this is the actual seismic, which is shown in the black color, which is the desired. But once you define the steep slopes, then you will have the Gibbs effect, so which is normally looks like this orange color. And over here you can see this one is defined, and you can see the lot of ringing effects in this. So thank you so much, and hope you have enjoyed this video, and hope to see you in the next lecture. Thank you.